We're now almost ready to see our first piece of quantum cryptography, namely the quantum one-time pad. But in order to talk about this, we will need a slightly more general way of writing down qubits. I'm going to assume here that you are familiar with what a qubit is. Mathematically, it is a vector in a complex space of dimension 2 to the n, where n is the number of qubits, and this vector has length 1. If you don't know about this yet, I encourage you to watch week 0, where we will teach you all about this mathematical description of qubits. You might be asking, why do we need a more general mathematical description? What's wrong with these vectors? There are two problems if we are talking only about vectors, and the first one arises if we think about two qubits. Let's call these qubits A and B, and of course I can write down the state of these two qubits in terms of a vector psi AB. Now some of these vectors are entangled, meaning that we cannot express them as a tensor product of some vector of qubit A and some vector for qubit B. And we will explore in detail what it means for a qubit to be entangled later. An example is the state down here. But now the question arises, if I now want to write down the state of qubit A, how can I do that? How can I, from this overall vector psi AB, find a mathematical description to work with for qubit A? Our formalism does not allow that. This is the first problem that we want to overcome with a more general description of qubits. There's also another problem why thinking about vectors is somewhat unsatisfactory. Let's imagine that we have a process, let's say a box, that prepares some states with some probabilities. For example, inside this box there might be a qubit. You've measured that qubit, you got some measurement outcome j with some probability pj, and the post-measurement state of the qubit is psi j. If you don't tell me what the measurement outcome j is, I don't know what state actually comes out. I only know that it's psi j with some probability pj. How can I mathematically write down a description of the resulting qubit state? Of course, you might say, well, I just have to carry around that it was in the state psi j with probability pj. But this quickly gets extremely complicated. Again, we want a more general description, a more general way of writing down a qubit that doesn't have this particular problem of being so complicated. What does such a general description look like? The first step is just by replacing vectors by matrices. So from my vector, I go to a matrix. Quite often, we like to call these matrices row. A matrix row associated to the state psi can be computed by taking the ket of psi times the bra of psi, which is just the outer product. This gives me a matrix. To see how this works, let's compute this matrix row, the so-called density matrix for the element of the standard basis 0. So I want to compute the density matrix 0, 0. So I take 0, 1. This here is the conjugate transpose of the vector. So what I get is a matrix that looks like 1, 0, 0, 0. It's useful to have a look at another example. So let's compute the density matrix for the state plus, given by 0 plus 1. So if I write out this vector, 1 over square root 2, 1, 0, 4, 0, plus 0, 1 for the 1 state. So what I get is 1 over square root 2, 1, 1. So if I want to compute the density matrix now, plus, plus, I have 1 over square root 2 times 1 over square root 2, which gives me a half. I have 1, 1, 1, 1. So the overall density matrix is a half, 1, 1, 1, 1. This is the way we can write down a qubit vector is a density matrix. So far, so good. You might be saying, that's great. I've taken a vector. I made it a matrix. But how have I solved these two problems? The nice thing is that if we talk about density matrices, we can easily solve our two problems. We'll start here with problem 2. And problem 1 we will return to shortly in another video. Namely, here we will consider how to write down the state of a qubit if I only know that it's in state psi j with probability pj. The rule will be that the density matrix will just be an average. Namely, we will be summing over j. And with probability pj, I put here the density matrix that I would have computed for the vector psi j. You might be asking, this seems pretty obscure. Why would this be a useful description? In order to see that this is useful, let's consider the probabilities of measurement outcomes. Remember that if my system was really in the state psi j, given psi j, then if I measure my qubit in the standard basis, the probability of getting outcome 0 would just be given by the inner product squared of psi j and 0. It's useful to write this out in terms of the trace. Of course, a trace is normally computed for a matrix, and this here is just a number. But of course, the trace of a number is also just this number, so I can put the trace for free. Now, there's a nice property of the trace that you can also read about in the lecture notes, namely that the trace is cyclic. This means that I can take this vector at the end and move it in the front. This means that I now have a trace of a density matrix of 0 times the density matrix of psi j. Let's now see what this means in terms of this density matrix sum over j that we defined above. We would expect that the probability of observing outcome 0 would just be the average, meaning that if with probability pj I actually have the state psi j, And for the state psi j, I have a certain probability of getting a zero. Then my overall probability of seeing a zero would be given by this term. So a good definition of a density operator should give us back this property. Let's plug in the probability of seeing outcome 0 given that the state was psi. So this term here. And we've just computed this above. And we can plug it here. So now observe that the trace is linear, meaning that we can take the sum over j and move it to the inside. But now this is just what we had defined our density matrix rho to be. With a seeing that if for a density matrix, the probability of observing outcome 0 is just the trace of rho times the density matrix of 0. With a seeing that this density matrix formalism seems to be a sensible solution to our second problem. Let me just summarize what is formally a density matrix. Mathematically, a density matrix is nothing else than a matrix which is Hermitian, meaning it's equal to its conjugate transpose, and all its eigenvalues are positive. This condition can also be written as follows, where we say that rho is positive semi-definite. The other condition is that rho has trace 1. The sum of the diagonal entries of rho are 1. And if we measure a density matrix in the basis, given by the vectors B, then the probability of observing measurement outcome B is given by the following expression. So why do we want these two properties? We have said that if we measure in the basis where B is a basis element, then the probability of observing outcome B is just given by this expression. Again, using the fact that the trace is cyclic, I can write this expression. SB applied to rho. Of course, this should be positive, since probabilities are positive numbers. And this means that rho cannot have any negative eigenvalues. The probabilities should also sum up to 1. So again, if I plug this definition here, if sum over B, trace of B with rho. And as you can explore in the lecture notes, if I sum over all the basis elements of some basis, I get the identity. So using the trace is linear, this means that the trace of the identity with rho, or just the trace of rho, should be 1. Mathematically, this is the description of a density matrix, sometimes also called density operator. There are two kinds of density matrices we will distinguish. In the first case, where we just took a vector psi and we turned it into a matrix. The resulting matrix has rank 1. Such a density matrix is also called a pure density matrix or a pure state. If a density matrix row has rank larger than 1, then we will call it a mixed density matrix. Or a mixed state. As you can think, if I have a process that gives me one state with probability p1, another one with probability p2, and we're mixing all these probabilities, the result is a mixture, and we call this a mixed state. To see how this works, let's consider an example. Let's construct the density matrix for a system that with probability half produces a0 and with probability half produces a plus. So let me just do that. So this here we computed before gives me half times 1, 0, 0, 0. This here gives me a half, 1, 1, 1, 1. If I compute the density matrix, I now average these two. Which gives me a half times 1, 0, 0, 0, plus. So the half came from the 1 of square root 2. The half here comes from the fact that I choose it with probability half. So this gives me a quarter, 1, 1, 1, 1. Which gives me a matrix that looks like 3 quarters. Quarter, quarter, quarter. This is an example of a density matrix.